pilotsafety.org provides free and low-cost safety classes all over the U.S. with the help from Avemco Insurance, the national sponsor of the FAA Wings program. Our speaker today is Gary GPS, the guy in the pink shirt Reeves, from pilotsafety.org. Gary has over 8,000 hours, is an ATP, and a master flight instrument multi-engine instructor. He is a lead rep for the FAA safety team and speaks for free at every large national convention. Of the 112,000 instructors in the U.S., less than 800 have ever been named master instructor. Gary is one of only 9 from the great state of Texas. Gary was chosen to be the only national training provider for 2 huge companies in aviation, Avadyne and Genesis. He is the top national expert in single pilot IFR, using autopilots, ForeFlight, Avadyne, and Garmin Avionics. He has sold over 10,000 copies of his mastery training videos. Gary travels all over the world, from Alaska to Australia, to help pilots master single pilot IFR. He has trained aircraft owners and airline crews in everything from small single engine piston, turboprop, and jets. Gary recently released his first book that has sold over 500 copies before it was even printed. This is a must-have book for any IFR student, pilot, or instructor that wants to have mastery, not minimum skills. Please welcome the guy in the pink shirt, the 2019 FAA National CFI of the Year, Gary GPS Reeves.
Woohoo! Yay! Woohoo! Either clap louder or I'll put that picture back up. How y'all doing? Oh no, you gotta be better than that. This is my 6th day in Florida and about my 12th class. How y'all doing? Cool, I'm okay with it being fake. I was dealing with some AV issues. Make sure you get a card. There's some back on the main table as you walk in. Make sure you fill it out, name, email address, as neat as you possibly can. And the class name is GPS Pro Tips, and give it to me before you leave. The FAA safety team, about a week ago, was handed an order that no one is allowed to give Wings credits for any public meeting at Sun and Fun 2021, because that would encourage people like you to get together in a public meeting, and I got it. I'm still appealing that decision, and I'm going to try and give you Wings credit for coming. If I can't get you Wings credit, I'm entering you all in a drawing to get one of my new books. I only printed 100 hardbacks, and I'm entering you to win one of my signed limited edition hardback editions. So if I can't get you safety credit, at least you might have a chance to win something. So make sure you get this back to me. So what we're going to cover today: definitions, talk about the units, how best to flight plan and program, the easiest way to use them in flight, when to load and activate approaches, because they're different even in Garmin. Who's got a Garmin GPS? Awesome, right? The Garmin 430 and 530 versus the GTN act differently, okay? Who here's got an Avadyne FMS? That's a different animal. So I'm gonna show you when to use them all. Why you should never program vectors to final, but you should always accept the request. How to fly to alternates, using with iPads, the training you need, and if I get any time, I'll take some questions. Definitions. A GPS is Garmin. How many people have a Garmin GPS? How many people remember when the Garmin 430, 530 changed the world? Like, just one of the greatest things that ever happened to GA, right? The only problem is you got carpal tunnel from entering the flight plans, right? You know, the Garmin 435-30s are still one of the most popular GPS units ever built. It's a GPS because if you load an approach, it wants you to manually activate it. There's safety reasons why they designed it that way. They want pilot confirmation. That is different than a flight management system. A flight management system does more things automatically for you. So Garmin makes great GPS, Avadyne makes great FMS. They're just a slightly different technology. Garmin does make FMS, but not for the light GA world. The 3000 and 5000 in the jets and turboprops are more of a true FMS. So everyone here have their iPhone? Everyone pull out your iPhone. You're totally welcome to do a 10-second video clip of me, but AOPA is putting it, this whole presentation up on YouTube. But what I'd like you to do is if you see a slide you like for your particular GPS, that you take a picture of it and keep it and share it to Facebook and all that other stuff. So who here's got their iPhone out? Does anybody here have an Android? Why? I mean, yay, you are the rebels. Yes, the dark side will lose. Good for you. Okay, good. All right. I think the Androids just take better pictures, right? Okay. So who's got the Garmin 435-30? Just one of the greatest things to ever hit GA. They're getting a little older, 1998, and it was the second WAAS GPS ever released. Absolutely the best available at the time and still very strong and good. It was totally discontinued in 2011. Garmin will still work on them for a flat fee repair, I believe, right? That's still correct. They're still selling pretty high prices on eBay. But if the Garmin 430 was the second WAAS, what's the first? The Garmin 480. No, it wasn't a Garmin. They bought, the Garmin 480 bought it from who? No. You know the little guys in the brown shorts? They invented WAAS GPS for general aviation. This came out of UPS Air Transport. They invented the WAAS GPS for aviation. They sold it to Apollo for general aviation. Garmin went, we'll take that. And that's how you got the Garmin 480. Anybody here have a Garmin, Apollo, or UPS SAT 480? I couldn't get it out of that guy's plane for any amount of money if I had a gun. These people, it is a cult because it's a true flight management system. They are so bulletproof. And like, if you ever find a used one on eBay for 10 grand, buy it. You can flip it tomorrow for 20. They are bulletproof units. They are really wonderful. All right, who's got the Garmin G1000, 2000 Perspective, G900? They all work pretty much the same. Amazing, 2004. They were the second big glass panel integrated GPS, PFD, MFD. Who was the first? Avadyne. Avadyne released the R9 first. Unfortunately, the 1000, you can't add it to an older plane, but with the integrated GFC autopilot and VNAV, it's some pretty cool stuff. Now, Garmin is wonderful about saying, here's the unit, would you like fries with that? And you go, yes, because the Garmin add-ons are really valuable. To see jet plates instead of the government plates, to add synthetic vision, to have XM radio, ADS-B weather and traffic. Who's got a Garmin GTN 650, 750? Is that like the prettiest display you've ever seen, right? 2011 release, it is touchscreen only for 96% of the functions. You cannot change a radio frequency and make it active. You cannot activate direct to an airport without the touchscreen functioning. So just so you know, it is truly a touchscreen only device. Extra options, but by making it touchscreen only, they got rid of the buttons to give you a bigger map. So there's pluses and minuses to everything. Of course, you can pay extra for all the gadgets, right? Who's got the Avidyne? Buttons and knobs. It came out 1 year later than the GTN. Touchscreen buttons, tabs, and a wireless keyboard. You don't have to buy a FlightStream. Wireless and Bluetooth are built in for free. Synthetic vision's included for free. Of course, it can connect almost any program to it. And you have to pay extra for the other gadgets. So let's talk about flight planning. You shouldn't ever flight plan on a Garmin, Avidyne, Bendix King, GPS, or FMS system. You don't flight plan once you're in the cockpit. You flight plan the week before on 4Flight. Who here's got 4Flight? Who here's got something else? Why? I mean, oh, you're the Android owners. Okay, that's fine. There are a bunch of great programs like what, FlyQ, Flight Plan Go. Does anybody use Garmin Pilot? It's pretty strong. The cool thing about Garmin Pilot is kind of works like the GTN, right? So you flight plan on your tablet and then you fly in the airplane. You shouldn't be flight planning in a cockpit. So, which means you should know your clearance, your IFR clearance, before you ever call for it, and you have to program the GPS or FMS system before you even release the brakes. This is one of the most common things. How many people have seen people on Facebook rant and rave against the children of the Magenta Line, right? And you're too reliant on technologies, and you need to be able to do it the old way. How many of them that rant and rave against technology realize they're posting on Facebook from a mobile computer? You know, I know you hate touchscreen only, and I know you hate technology, but when you're posting those comments from your iPhone, you lose a little bit of credibility, right? But you gotta program the GPS first, because one of the most common mistakes, who in the room are flight instructors? Raise your hands high. If you're looking for a flight instructor, I would hire one of these folks. Most flight instructors don't take enough continuing education. These all are the pros. Flight instructors would agree with me, the biggest problem with technology is that people who don't know how to use it spend too much time heads down, right? And it is a very common thing for Avemco several times a year to pay for that because somebody was programming the GPS while they were taxiing, okay? If you're not in that big a hurry. So the easiest way to use in flight, well, there's some tricks. The G1000 has 57 unique buttons and knobs. I just don't use most of them. What I want you to do is never take your left hand off the yoke or the flight controls and only use your right hand when you work the G1000. Instructors, left hand, right? Because it's what you're used to. Who learned in a plane with old NavCom VOR stuff, right? Wasn't everything done by your right hand anyway? We'll do it that way on the G1000. The G1000 is very easy to use. I mean, look, the audio panel's at the top. COM 1 and COM 2 are on the left. NAV 1, NAV 2 are on the right. It works just like your body already knows how to do it. So if you let the muscle memory take over, you can maintain safety of flight, okay? So I do hear, who's got the GTNs? I do hear a lot of people say, well, you don't wanna buy the GTN because it's touchscreen only, and in turbulence, they're hard to work. These same people are using 4Flight on a touchscreen only iPad. Well, if you can work your iPad, you can work a GTN. But the GTN, the touchscreen, it is a little harder to work in moderate turbulence. Severe turbulence, it's very hard. But you can, Garmin actually designed in some things to help you. If you simply put your fingers on the anchoring bezels, it is much easier to get what you need done, okay? So if you put your thumb there, right finger, still get direct. The thing is when you put your right hand up from the bottom, you put it around that radio tuning knob, just be careful not to push in the direct too. But even in moderate and higher turbulence, by anchoring my fingers like that, I teach Garmin all the time, it is much, much easier. It really, really is. Now, the Avidyne in turbulence is just a little bit simpler. I just push the button, right? Or I don't use the buttons at all. Avidyne includes a free Bluetooth keyboard that is Velcroed to my yoke. I never take my hands off the flight controls, and I have total control. I never have to touch the actual Avidyne FMS. I can do everything from the wireless keyboard. Anybody in here a rotor pilot? Right? So when I teach helicopter people how to use Avidyne and Garmin stuff, Avidyne, the helicopter people love it because they Velcro the keyboard to their knee pad so they don't have to let go of stuff, right? Because it is a little awkward in a helicopter in turbulence to let go and do that. Does anybody know the difference between stable and unstable? Stable is an airplane, unstable is a helicopter. That's all you need to know. But they are incredibly fun to fly. All right, using with an iPad, it's pretty simple. So this happens to be an Avidyne demo. I'm gonna show a bunch of Garmin demos here in a minute. It just Wi-Fi's over to any iPad. Now, how many of you have a Garmin device with the Garmin FlightStream 210 and 510? Isn't that great to share flight plans back and forth? How many of you have the Avidyne and you connect for flight? Yeah, don't do that. I'm gonna say something a little controversial. My personal recommendation is to never connect your ForeFlight navigation system to the panel. I only want it to an independent Stratus 3 in the back. Let me tell you why. Garmin and Avidyne have the most bulletproof, reliable systems ever invented. Neither one works in a total electrical failure. I was flying a G1000 equipped airplane over the desert at night. I heard a pop and the screens went black and I lost all my interior lighting. It wasn't a defect in the G1000. There wasn't a defect in the standby battery. The defect was the aircraft battery was bad and shorted out everything. If your ForeFlight is connected to your transponder or your navigation system and you have an electrical failure, you now have no navigation at all. So how many people learned IFR when you were worried about vacuum failure? Dude, what's a vacuum failure? I don't think they even make vacuum pumps anymore. Your nightmare is not the vacuum failure anymore. Yours is the surprise total electrical failure. So if you have Garmin Pilot or ForeFlight or FlyQ connected to an independent GPS AHARS, you can still do an approach in an emergency. I know it's convenient to share flight plans, but the GTN and the Avidynes, it's so quick to put in a flight plan anyway, you really are not saving a ton of time. Avidyne works with almost everything. Garmin typically only works with ForeFlight and Garmin Pilot. So this is a way to send one to the flight up. Again, I just don't think it's all that much a savings, but it works really well. Garmin GTN, like I said, just make sure you touch it. Now, the one cool thing about Garmin is if it's connected to Garmin Pilot or ForeFlight and you make a change on the GTN, it automatically updates ForeFlight. But you lose the safety of an independent backup, so. So when do you load and activate approaches? I'm on time, that is amazing. On everything. You load the approach before you ever take off. Gonna say something a little controversial. If you got a weather briefing, you should know what approach you're gonna shoot when you get there, and it's not what's on the ATIS. How many of you have heard people say, well, I don't know what approach I'm gonna shoot until I get close enough to hear the ATIS? Oh, come on, I knew the winds yesterday. I know I'm gonna do the RNAV 17 center or the RNAV 18 center at DFW when I get there. Well, but the ATIS says the ILS is in use. I don't work for an ATIS. In fact, your initial approach fix should be part of your flight plan. So it works like this. If you plan correctly and you include the initial approach fix of Zoom key for an RNAV 17 in Decatur, Texas, you've already got an IFR clearance to Zoom key, right? So when you check in with your last TRACON, like regional, good afternoon, station air 49er 41 Foxtrot, level 6000 direct Zoom key, RNAV 17 full stop, Decatur with the current weather and NOTAMs. And they go, cleared for the approach. In 8 years of traveling the US and internationally to teach, have had to change approaches three times from the one I planned before I ever took off. Why? Somebody geared up on my runway and I had to sidestep. Okay? So you should know the initial approach fix and you should know the approach before you take off. The problem is if you file to the airport and then you add an approach later, you have broken the flight plan or created a discontinuity called a gap in route. It's a GIGO error. Can you all pretend to be a computer for just a half second? I need you to be a computer. Does this make sense? Fly from Orlando to the center of Lakeland Airport, overfly the airport, then leave and begin an instrument approach. So if you build a flight plan and then add an approach, that doesn't make sense. And that's why people call me all the time and go, well, I had the approach loaded, but it never activated. Because you told it not to. You told it to go to the center of the airport first. That's a GIGO error. Now you activate when you get there on the Garmin devices, Avidyne's will self-activate. So let's do a procedure on a GTN. So I'm gonna leave Victorville, I'll go down to Long Beach. I'm gonna click add waypoint. I'm gonna touch Hector. That fast find thing is amazing, right? How many people on the Garmin 43530 would load a VOR and he'd go, do you want the one here or in Brazil? Well, let's go here first, right? So this fast find thing is a pro. How do you know you've got a good instructor? How do you know the instructor you've hired to teach you the GTN actually knows the GTN? When they stop typing and use the fast find, because they actually understand the shortcuts. All right, so there's KLGB. You notice Seal Beach is in my flight plan. Now, when I load the RNAV Zulu, never load vectors, always load the full approach. Seal Beach, load approach, there's no gap in route. Do you see how it's not going to the airport and then coming back? Because you put the initial approach fix in your flight plan first. Right? So if you want to preview that, what I recommend everybody with a GTN do is go to the map view and drag and make sure your flight plan doesn't have any breaks in it. Those are the discontinuity gaps in route. And this one, look, see how it's one continual flight plan? So the best way to flight plan is GPS direct to the initial approach fix, then the airport, then load the procedure from the initial. That'll backfill and make a lot more sense, okay? That doesn't work on Garmin 43530s and G1000. There's a workaround. Avidyne's pretty simple because Avidyne's an FMS. You don't have to activate the procedure when you get there. It just does it. So we'll do the same thing. Hector, the geofill on Avidyne's a little bit quicker than the fast find for Garmin. We'll just Victor Airway, Paradise, add in Seal Beach or Victor 8 to Seal Beach probably. No, we'll just go Seal Beach. Waypoint, KLGB. A cool thing about the Avidyne is when you're flying Victor Airways, in the background it auto-tunes the next VOR for you in case there's a GPS outage. How many people fly with Garmin stuff? My suggestion is A, you shouldn't be on a Victor Airway. Nobody wants you on a Victor Airway except three very rare exceptions. B, if you're on a Victor Airway, make sure you're manually tuning the VORs as you fly, because GPS outages happen, trust me, okay? And it's a little bit easier to preview on the Avidyne because you can change it to view cursor. And then as you highlight each waypoint by turning the right knob, it actually acts like a video game and flies each leg for you. The other cool thing about the Avidyne is it never suspends on a missed approach. If you have a Garmin device and you hit the missed approach point, it always puts up the black screen. Did you land or do you need missed approach help? And you always have to say unsuspend and switch back to GPS, right? If you have the Garmin autopilot and you wire up a go-around switch, when you trigger go-around, that will unsuspend the Garmin and go back to GPS. The Avidyne just does it automatically every time. You don't need any special switches. Vectors to final. Don't do it. Now, don't get me wrong. I'm not saying don't accept vectors to final. I'm saying never program it unless you said mayday, mayday, mayday. This is a controversial thing. I teach techniques nobody else teaches. How many of you own your own airplanes? Hey, Wayne. Everybody look back at Wayne. Wayne, wave. Not gonna wave. Train of thought derailed, killed 20, news at 11. How many of you own your own airplane? How many of you pay for your own gas? If ATC says, would you like vectors to final? The answer is yes, but never program it in the box. Always load the full procedure from an initial approach fix and activate the leg to final. When you hit vectors to final, it deletes all the other waypoints in the procedure and just draws a 30-mile pink line. That's great until ATC changes their mind. How many people have been on vectors to final and they say, approach clearance canceled, proceed direct Zoom key? And you went, I don't have Zoom key anymore, I've deleted it. Always load the full procedure, activate the leg to final. So I sell video training because I think video training is easier to learn a system than reading the book. Anybody ever read the POH for anything ever built in an airplane? And they're written really well from an engineering standpoint, but they're not great. So I sell video training, and people ask me, well, what's the difference between your video training and like the Sporties or the King G1000 courses? Well, mine are filmed in moving airplanes. They're not done in studios. So mine is real world technique. Theirs is very good, but it's a different type of training. So before I tell you this, anybody who buys my G1000, GTN, Avidyne, whatever training, some of the video is a little bumpy because we're in the clouds in real IMC. So let me show you this one. This is the localizer DME 2.4 to Fullerton. Outside of zero, you need to be at or above what? Outside of hammock, you need to be at or above what? This is the audience participation part. That's 2,500. Outside of QD, you need to be at or above what? Now here's the problem. If you activate vectors to final, you delete hammock and zero. And if you're at 3,000, you don't know when you can now descend because you've deleted it. Let me show you what it looks like on a G1000. So this is a G1000 Diamond Star doing that localizer approach. I push a couple buttons, tune in my nav frequency. I'm gonna hit the procedure button in just a second. There's my final controller, flip, SoCal, Diamond Star, whatever, procedure, activate vectors to final. Now look at the map view. You see all those waypoints? When I do vectors to final, it deletes all those waypoints. It still shows them on the map, but my GPS reference is now only to QD, and it's not legal to descend by a airplane position. You're supposed to have the waypoint as part of the flight plan. So it may show the waypoints, but you've lost your legal guidance. So the better way to do it is to load the full approach and then activate the leg you're going to intercept. Because that way everything's still there. So if you activate the leg to final, it's the same as vectors to final. You still save $2 in gas. You still get the shortcut. But when ATC goes, wait a minute, you're already ready. And you don't have to reload the procedure. The biggest killer of pilots is not C-fit, stall spin, any of that stuff. The two killers of pilots are decision fatigue and adrenaline paralysis. Once you're at the end of a single pilot IFR flight, you get tired, your decisions are not as good. When you now have to reload procedures at the very end, you're increasing your workload and you're reducing your safety. So load it once and be done. And you can see how I've activated the leg on this. If you're gonna intercept inside of the leg you've activated, just activate the next leg. The one thing you must never do, and this is a very common mistake, you cannot on any GPS or FMS system go direct to the final approach fix. If you highlight the final approach fix in your flight plan and you hit direct to enter, enter, it deletes the procedure. You can't do that, okay? So flying to alternates. How many of you have had to go missed for real and divert to an alternate? Doesn't happen very often though, right? The thing is on the Garmin 430 and 530, you can't put your alternate airport at the end of a flight plan. It doesn't work like that. Garmin only allows one instrument approach in the memory chain. So you can't preload stuff like that, right? So what you need to do is before you get in the airplane, create a separate flight plan on 4Flight FlyQ Garmin Pilot Flight Plan Go from the missed approach hold point to the initial approach fix of the procedure you want to shoot at your alternate and then any navigation you need in between. If you don't have a flight plan ready for your alternate, air traffic control will have no idea what you want. Listen, I teach all over the world, and I go missed for real, because I'll take a student down to published minimums or below, and we go missed, and look, we're just trying to clean up the airplane. All right, go missed. Who's been taught climb, cram, all that stuff? Don't ever do that. Every pilot I've ever trained, some of them with 60,000 hours, every pilot I've ever trained descends and goes below minimums because they've been taught to do that. Well, the problem is when you do this, you push the nose down. Every pilot I've ever trained dives and goes below minimums when they try and do the go around too quick because they do this. Ready? Minimums. Disconnect, lean back. Your left hand pulls the nose up to 5 to 7 degrees as your right hand pushes like that. Get in the habit of leaning back to do that. Then if you have a Garmin, unsuspend, back to GPS, put your autopilot back in GPS steering, vertical speed, altitude capture, and ATC will immediately say before you even get to the hold, say intentions. I want to clean up the plane and get into the hold. Okay. Well, say your intentions now. I need my Red Bull. I'll be right back. That was not part of the class, but I do appreciate my Red Bull. That's what I tell ATC. I go, I'm not ready to tell you what I need next because I don't know what I need next. Before I wander off to my alternate, I need to check weather at my alternate. It may not be any better than where I am now. And then I say, okay, I'd like to proceed to my alternate of Fresno. And then they go, do you have a flight plan on file for that? Putting an alternate on your flight plan form is not the same as having a flight plan from your missed approach point to your alternate. And you go, no. And they go, well, how do you want to get there? Well, I don't know. All right, well, we'll make up something for you, and then you're reprogramming. So if you do all this before you get in the plane, all you do is you save a flight plan from your missed approach hold point, not your destination airport, from the hold point. So if you're holding at Wuxi, your alternate flight plan starts from Wuxi. Fly your procedure hold like normal. When ATC clears you, or if you lose ATC, you just open the flight plan menu and activate your side flight plan. Anybody with a Garmin 430, 530, or G1000, take a picture of that screen. Most instructors have never been taught how to do that. So everybody take a picture. Wait. Oh, you want one with me out of it. Okay, good. Make sure you post that on social media and share it with others, please. Now, flying to alternates on the GTN is a little bit easier because you can continue your flight plan, but you can't load a second procedure. So what I do is just, I keep my flight plan going, but I can't load the second procedure. So this is how you do it on GTN. Now here's the problem. On a Garmin GTN or G3000, 5000 or whatever, if you say, well, I want to load my new procedure at my alternate, you'll delete the hold you're flying. So don't load the new procedure until you've already left the hold point, okay? Avidine's a little bit easier. Let's just do this. After Avidine with the missed approach point right there, I'll just continue over to Seal Beach. Scroll down. Let's go to, what did I put in? I forgot. Oh, Aheim. And then I'm going to go up to Pomona, and I'll do the VOR Alpha at Pomona. This is something you can only do on an Avidine. How many people remember their instrument check ride where you do three back-to-back approaches? You can load all three approaches at three different airports before you ever take off. It'll self-activate every one and self-activate the missed. You can, in an Avidine, you can have 100 airports with two approaches at each airport that will all self-activate and go missed automatically before you ever take off. Anybody here working on their instrument rating? If you have an Avidine, the examiner must tell you before you go, we're gonna do this approach, then this approach. And then you go, okay, so before I take off, I'm gonna load this approach, then this approach, then this approach, and the examiner will go, what you doing? Well, getting everything done before I take off. The easiest way for you to be safer is how much can you do before you take off? That's probably the biggest advantage Avidine has, is you can load multiple procedures all in the same flight plan. All right, now, how many of you have the Garmin stuff? You are very lucky, it's an awesome product. How many of you have the Avidine stuff? You are very lucky, it's an awesome product. I want you to practice not using them at all. Now look, I am the guy in the pink shirt. I think nobody should ever fly an ILS again because LPV is much more precise and much more accurate. A lot of ILS procedures actually prohibit the autopilot for the last 200 feet. You'll never get an autopilot prohibition on LPV because they're much more stable. I would never shoot an ILS unless GPS was broken. I would never use my iPad with ForeFlight as my sole and primary reference in IMC unless it was an emergency. So if you hire me for my 3-day courses, it's 20 hours. It's actually 40 hours of training because you watch 20 hours of video training before I get there. And then in 3 days, I do 20 hours in your airplane. It is brutal. It is exhausting. And on the third day, when you're like, oh, I get it, and I understand all the buttons, and I see what my autopilot does, and I go, great, and I put you under the hood, and I turn off your master switch, and I cover up all your standby gauges, and I say, okay, we're gonna use ForeFlight to do a GPS procedure, and you have to get me down to 100 feet above the runway using ForeFlight only. Do I really do that to people? Oh, yeah, because let me ask you a question. Does anybody know the definition of the word emergency? Let me help you out. If we go out to the hot dog stand, and there's this adorable, cute little girl, pippy long stockings, red hair and freckles, bright blue, not breathing at all, completely choking, and the mother is being a mother, and freaking out. Is that an emergency? No, why would it be? I was a paramedic. I'm gonna walk up, put down my Red Bull, pick up the kid, go honk, take the hot dog, go up to the mom and go, don't feed your kid hot dogs. Pick up my Red Bull and go, see ya. You know why it's not an emergency? Because I've been trained on how to handle it. The definition of an emergency is something you haven't practiced for. I had a real engine fire at 200 feet after takeoff. Anybody ever had bright orange fire coming out of the engine cowling, bouncing off your windshield at 200 feet before? And I went, let go. And the students all, ah! And I'm like, yes, let go. Ah! Yes, let go. Boom, let go. How many have heard the impossible turn thing? How many people know you're supposed to shut the engine off when you have fire, right? That would kill you. Full power overboost. The fire got brighter. I dropped it into a 70 degree bank at 200 feet. Teardrop back, landed, cut off the fuel. Stepped outside of the airplane, and the student's like, I'm like, come on. He's just like, woo. And I'm like, yeah, I know. Come on. You know, the only reason I survived that is because I was a 135 pilot and I had practiced low altitude engine fires multiple times in the simulator before it happened for real. So your only chance of surviving a total electrical failure at night in IMC is you got two options. You can dead wreck into a VOR and dead wreck in an approach. That's a lot of dead for me. Or you'll be very glad your iPad is connected to an independent Stratus 3 in the back and you still have a full and complete AHARS, ADS-B weather and traffic, and everything you need. Do I really do this to my students? Well, yeah, but let me ask you a question. Could you all, how many of you have flown a G-1000 equipped airplane? Is that really much different? Now, it's a GPS ground speed, not airspeed. It's a GPS altitude, not a barrel-corrected indicated altitude. But if you only used the rudders for turns and you made real small corrections, how many of you could do this? All of you, if you have practiced it with a master instructor before it happens for real. So when I say I do it to students, I really do it to students. Let's see Charles. Oh, Charles. Ding, ding, ding. Yeah, let's just black out everything and make him do a DME arc approach using for flight only. And he did very, very well. All right, so the biggest thing about all avionics is you need to learn how to work them before you go fly with them. Who are my instructors? What's your name?
My name's Greg.
I'm a private pilot with 200 hours with an instrument rating. I'm a very good private pilot. I do want to add my multi-engine rating, but I think instead of hiring an instructor, I'm just going to watch a couple YouTube videos, take the plane up in the air, and just practice engine failures until I figure it out.
Bad idea.
How many of you learned your avionics doing that? It's a bad idea. Trial and error is a very ineffective way to learn aviation. How many of you learned for flight by watching a couple YouTube videos and playing with it in a moving airplane? It's not as effective. So people say, well, trial and error is how people learn how to land. No, that's not correct. Any great instructor will say, we don't do trial and error to learning to land. We do something called guided practice. This is how you do it right. Now you're gonna do it with me. And after several times, then you let them solo, right? So Avnine and Garmin are very complex systems. Do you think pilots and flight instructors before they fly these planes should know all that stuff? Right? What are the common mistakes that people who are not formally trained make? What kind of mistakes do you think they make if they don't know how to be an expert at their avionics? They pick up a lot of bad habits, like what? You can't make him do all the work, folks. Somebody's got to help him. All right, let's see if you agree with me. You think they spend too much time heads down? A lot of instructors do not allow their students to use an iPad during primary training. That is a huge, giant mistake. If you don't teach them how to use for flight correctly from day one on the demo flight, they'll just use it wrong after they pass. Look, you gotta teach iPads from day one, but you gotta teach them how to work it correctly. Because people who don't know how to work iPads and GPS systems are like this when they don't see the giant plane in front of them, right? They rely on traffic and weather. When you see a green flag on for flight, that means the airport is what? VFR. With a 35 knot gust and crosswind, freezing rain, hail, but the ceiling is at 5,000 and there's 5 miles of visibility. The green flag don't mean nothing. By the way, how does Garmin and Avidyne depict a VFR airport on their maps? In light blue, it's opposite for flight. But you can't rely on weather. ADS-B weather by nature is a minimum of 12 minutes old before it's ever sent out. So when we do a radar sweep of a sector, it takes 8 to 12 minutes to build the picture. Then we transmit it to the XM satellites or the FISB ADS-B system. So if you're looking at radar on your Garmin Avidyne handheld, thunderstorms can move at 40 to 50 knots. They can throw 3/4-inch hail 35 miles out from the epicenter, and the picture you're looking at is 22 minutes old. You should not use any data link weather as tactical. It's strategic big picture, okay? You don't get a weather brief. So what do they need to know before they go fly? Well, you need to know the limitations. There are a lot of times you cannot use it. By the way, Garmin 430, 530, GTN and Avidyne require a pre-flight inspection item before every single flight, or you are not allowed to use them in IFR at all. And most people don't even know it's there. When you first turn on a 430, 530 or GTN, there's a test page. You must verify your HSI or OBS is half left, half up, a desired track, DDK of 150, indicating 10.0 nautical miles to Garmin. Avidyne, it's on the lawyer screen. Half left, half up, DTK 150, 10 nautical miles to Avidyne waypoint. If you don't verify that and you just blindly push enter, enter, enter to start loading flight plans, you are not allowed to use that navigator in IFR conditions. How to update the database, legal issues, how to program it, and this is what most people don't know. Most really great pilots I train don't know 80% of their Avidyne, Garmin, or ForeFlight system, because that wasn't part of the trial and error system, and almost none of them know how to quickly work it in emergencies. How many of you have the great Garmin stuff? The only beef I have with Garmin, and I love Garmin, everybody goes, you hate Garmin. No, I don't, I love Garmin. I've been teaching Garmin for 14 years. The only hard thing about Garmin system is there's 5 different ways to do everything you want to do. Well, it would be better if you just knew the shortcut version instead of the random long route, right? And Avidyne's just the same. So let me ask you a question. Is this person qualified to fly a GPS in a moving airplane? They've looked at the quick start guide. They've flown it 3 to 4 times. They've played with it in flight to see how it works. Are they qualified and safe? No. Get trained before you fly. You do not need to buy my videos, although my wife and I would much appreciate it. You can simply read the pilot's guide. What's really interesting is the ForeFlight Pilot's Guide is now well over 1,000 pages and longer than the G1000 Pilot's Guide, because the G1000 doesn't add 5 new features every 3 days, right? If you need help with any of this stuff and you're not a big fan of reading the manuals, I know a guy. That would be me. Just go over to pilotsafety.org, and I have free getting started videos with some paid video training on anything you put in an airplane most. I hate to beg, but